Banat, a marginal region of the Romanian territory, is from the beginning of its history an area of interaction, of blending, where population ethnically and culturally different exchange, communicate, cooperate, and sometimes confront. Historically, Banat can be considered a model of cohabitation, a reality easily recognized today. In the same context of the formation and development of Banat, Reșița appeared to becoming afterwards city and home for many German ethnics colonized here during the development of the factories from Reșița. The construction of the factories began on the 1st November 1769 and finished on the 3rd of July 1771. The qualified labor force was initially made up of craftsmen from the mining areas of Bocșa and Ocna de Fier, then of the colonists brought from Știrea, Carintea, Slovenia, and even from Rhine area. The colonization was accomplished in several stages in the year 1776, 1782, 1787, 1793, 1849, or 1866. In this way did the German colonists manage to settle in Reșița. They lived on these lands, they formed mixed families and contributed to the development of the area, and in this way did the industrialized Reșița form, and along with it the blending of population, which later, after the Second World War, led to massive deportation of the German population in the labor camps from the former Soviet Union. The Second World War was in Reșița too, like everywhere, a time of great distress. Under the command of General Antonescu, Romania entered the war against the Soviet Union on the morning of 21st June 1941. Whatever happened to the German community during the war, the documents compiled in 1945 and translated in Russian in order to be understood by the Soviet occupant as well, placed the beginning of the drama of the German ethnics from Romania immediately after the Vienna Diktat, when the old community of German ethnics from Romania becomes the German National Socialist Workers' Party, electing as Führer the young Andreas Schmidt on the 28th September. On the 20th November 1940, as acknowledged in achieved documents, the dictatorial government of Marshal Antonescu by the decree number 3884, published in the Official Monitor 257 from the 21st November, declares the German ethnic group from Romania as a public legal entity and the National Socialist Party as the representative of the national will of the mentioned ethnic group. The events from Nazi Germany became also the events of the German community from Romania. Thus, on the 20 April 1942, honoring Adolf Hitler's birthday, the leadership of the German youth from Romania ordered the enrollment of the children and youngsters in Nazi political organizations. Through Andreas Schmidt, they announced that the German ethnic group from Romania declares that its interests are the Reich interests, that every German group is a part of the Reich, whose great European mission it must represent wherever the German group activates. As far as Reșița is concerned, on the 6th December 1940, the Organization of the German Workers was created with 2,000 members, as well as the organizations of the German peasants organized in 19 districts with 294 local Führers. After the 23rd August 1944, the majority of these leaders left for Germany with the Nazi armies in withdrawal. Against the ordinary citizens, the drama of deportation in the Soviet Union unleashed. Thus, 67 years ago, in January 1945, after the Second World War, men between 16 and 45 years old and women between 18 and 30 years old, people capable of work from all the Romanian territory, German ethnics from Banat, Transylvania, Satu Mare, Bucovina, Dobruja, and Muntenia, were taken from their families and shipped in covered wagons far away in the frozen territories of nowadays Russia and Ukraine. Not few were those who lost their life there due to the hard conditions of labor and existence. In what follows, we present three stories of the deportation from Reșița in the former Soviet Union camps. A Romanian soldier and a Russian came home and told us to take food for 3 days because they were going to take us. And didn't they tell you where, what for? No, absolutely nothing. They told us only this, to have thick clothes, and they looked us in the place of culture. We stayed there a day and a night, and we slept on the floor. Then some trucks came. They took us to the train station where the covered wagons were prepared. 6 weeks we spent there. 6 weeks we slept on the boards. We were around 40 people, men and women. We had traveled for 6 weeks till we arrived there. How old were you then? Well, how old was I? 18. And after that, I couldn't wait to get off that train. Just imagine, 6 weeks without conditions, without water, without anything, and after that, we got off there in an orchard outside the city. We got off and we walked in the cold. They took us because they needed a labor force there, women from 17, 18 years old to 30 years old. And did you live with anybody else? You said that you didn't live with relatives. How about acquaintances from your street, neighbors? Were you all by yourself? I was the only one from my family, the only one that I left. Didn't you know anybody from that covered wagon? Yes, there were some acquaintances from the neighborhood, from where they gathered them. I had some acquaintances there, but after a while we split. They sent them to work in other areas. I was at an improvised hospital where they used to bring the sick. There were people who couldn't work anymore and they died there. It was very ugly. I was very thin, but I didn't have health problems. They took us to a camp in wooden barracks. We were 12 in a room with bunk beds. One autumn we moved from this camp to another, and there we were many more, but we couldn't sleep because of the bugs. The bugs were crawling everywhere. But then they took us from there, and we went to that hospital. Wasn't there a lot of work? Weren't there better conditions at the hospital? It was repulsive as well, but it was better because we didn't work outside in the frost. They moved us to the prisoners' camp, and there I worked in tailoring. When I worked in the mine, I worked at night. We had to wheel out and to load the wagons with sacks. It was very hard. We would get in the evening a loaf of bread. It was like a brick, black. Oh, dear me. I would eat all of it, and all day long we would only have some borscht because there wasn't any bread left. And when you were in tailoring, wasn't it better from this point of view? Yes, it was better. We worked for the Russians, for their wives, and it was all right there. It was all right? It was all right, because we didn't work outside in the frost. The first year was the hardest.
Cultural na dus acolo, dar eu am stat mai mult la cultural, că trebuia să vină și camioanele de acolo, de la ei, trebuia să vină și vagoanele.
They took us to the Palace of Culture. That's where I stood for quite a while, waiting for the trucks and the wagons, and it took about 2 weeks before they arrived. When they did, they told us to pack and get in the trucks. During this time, did your family try to find out your whereabouts? Well, I only had my mother. I didn't have anyone else. My mother made some inquiries. My mother was actually Czech. She tried to obtain a paper to exempt me so that I could stay home. But till she arrived with that paper, the covered wagons were already leaving. And she couldn't give me the paper anymore. And she couldn't get me off the wagon either. And I left and we went for about 2 weeks. And then we stopped at Ploiești. How could you measure time? How did you realize how much time passed? Did you have a watch? Well, there were girls who had a watch, and they told us. We arrived at Ploiești, and there was a soldier there, a Russian, and he asked from us some Romanian money because he would give us rubles. Rubles. I had money with me. My mother gave me 500 lei, but there was nothing I could do with it, so I kept it. I thought if I came back home, I would bring it back. because it was the same money. During those times, there weren't so many changes, but eventually bought my identity card and the money disappeared. On the way or in the camp? No, in the camp. I was in Donbas, and when we arrived, there was a new building, but as the lady said, we didn't have heating. The walls were glowing because of the ice, and we couldn't make fire because the smoke was coming back in the room. Therefore, we stayed in cold. We didn't have beddings. We didn't have anything. We would cover with the padded coat, and we had a hat instead of a pillow. They wanted to discover some stone quarry, but they couldn't find it. There was no stone. I worked, so to say, more than a year. Then they didn't have food to give us anymore in the camp and transferred us to Horlovka. There it was better. We had a warm barrack, bedding, everything. It was very good there. And eventually we got some money too. They would give us 350 rubles because they wouldn't give us food anymore without money. We had to pay for the food. So I stayed there for a year, almost two, till they released us, and then we came home in 1949. I had two brothers. One died in the army in the country. The other died on the battlefield in 1942 at Odessa. So I didn't have... My father died when I was 11 months, so I didn't have anyone to help me in such matters. As kids, we didn't think to blame someone. I don't know who was to be blamed. God knows. I know nothing. We weren't allowed to say a word to anyone when we arrived home. What it was like, what happened, absolutely nothing. We were forbidden to do it before we even left. You are forbidden to talk, they told us. What did you eat in the camp? We would eat only borscht or sour cucumbers and a bit of pearl barley boiled in water with salt, but without vegetables, potatoes, oil or grease, absolutely nothing. We were a lot of people in the room. There were two rooms. They looked like wagons, and there were a lot of people. There were beds with bunk beds, three levels high, and we were around 24 girls inside. And what about the hygiene? Could you wash up? No, we had only cold water. And once a week, they took us to the bathhouse and put our clothes in the van. I don't even know if we had soap, because nobody gave us soap. So that's how we washed. Once a week, they took us to the bathhouse. I arrived at the train station and I got off. And then my mother came with a neighbor. She sent the neighbor near the railway worker in the station where there was light. Did she know that you are going to come? She would come and see all the trains. Whether she knew it or not, she would go to see all the trains. And my mother left the neighbor there and she went to the engine and kept calling, Šoltisianu, Šoltisianu, Šoltisianu. But the neighbor said, hey, neighbor, Anushi is near me. And then she came closer and I started to cry. What was I supposed to do? Did she seem changed? Yes. And you too, probably. 5 years.
5 ani de zile.
The last deportees came back home in December 1949 after 5 years spent in extreme conditions in miserable camps meant for the reconstruction of the Soviet state. Of around 75,000 deported from Romania, it is estimated that a number of 10,000 people lost their life far away from home and from those that would care about their fate. I was in the last convoy, this is what they told me. There were the older people, elderly people, yes, older, and this is what I noticed there. There was also a woman there who was old. Listen, didn't you think of hiding or running? Madam, when they knock at your door and tell you, in 2 hours I'm coming after you and the Russian holds the gun, I was, how should I put it, stunned. But I knew they were taking people for work in the Soviet Union, but I didn't believe they were going to come here too. And the soldier stays in the doorstep and says, hey, pack your bag, you are on the list, look, from the city hall. We are coming after you at 2 o'clock. At 2 o'clock after they finished with the announcement, they came back and took us. They took us to the school, to the Catholic church, in the classroom full of people, all with luggage. Did you know anybody there in the whole classroom? There were neighbors from my street too. Suddenly some trucks came and took us with our luggage, quietly, without any order. Well, it was confusing. The fact that you must go, and how should I tell you that you haven't stolen anything? What have you done wrong? Why were they taking you? Nobody told you anything. That was it. You had to go. You cut 5 or 10 hens and took them to your neighbor. That was it. This is really what they did to us, without any preparation, nothing. As I told you, this is the way it happened. I saw there the packs. They took us out. They put us inside a house. We were already in the camp. From the train station to the camp, there was around 1 kilometer. And it was winter. We didn't know. We looked to the left, to the right. The kids called us names. Fritz, Germans. You know, the way the kids are. In the camp inside, we are already separated. I got the form earlier. I was 397. The number. The camp was full. There were 400 people. I was with 2 people from Reshica, 2 were from Boksha. We were 6 in the room, and they all worked. They didn't work with coal, but they were, how can I tell you, locksmith. I was together with another one. He was an electrician. I was a locksmith. My work in the mine was ironware. If a pipe burst or anything related to ironware, this is what I did. The electrician the same. When there was something wrong, he had to go. He wasn't allowed to go by himself, and neither was I. He hadn't been in a mine before, neither had I. I'll never forget him. This was something new, and we didn't know what dangers there were. But this is not what I want to say. We were put up there. Did they pay you all this time? We were. How should I put it? We worked. We didn't know how much money they were about to give us. There were bundles of clothes in the bathroom. You would take off your clothes and leave them there. When you would come back, you couldn't find your clothes anymore. As I'm telling you, I used to sleep on the top bank. We were all 3 electricians from Reshica, and those on the bottom banks were from Boksha. And another one was, I don't know, from these parts, and we slept there. He was an overseer, a supervisor, something. Was he Russian or one of you? One of us. I went with him to school. And was it hard? No, but I didn't know the language. The majority didn't know Russian. And why did they appoint that man? To work. He was a supervisor. There are places in the mine where there are poles, and above them there is a wooden board so that when stones fall down on the trucks, they would not fall on people. One time a board fell down with the nails up. The nails were still in the board. The board fell down and poor Stefan stepped on that board and the nail entered here and came out on the other side. Then his colleagues had to take him out, but there wasn't any doctor in the camp. No doctor, no medicine, nothing. There weren't any medicine there. There was nothing, nothing. What could we do with him? We took him in the camp. We didn't have anything to tie his wound. We tore some pants, we washed them, and he remained in the camp. There was a room with a bed. One could stay there only if one had temperature. I don't know how many degrees. Only then you were allowed it to absent yourself from work. Work. Otherwise you weren't. Yes, and we got everything, as I'm telling you. Clothes, food, house, bedding, everything. You couldn't leave the camp in the last period, and you also couldn't leave the locality. I have worked for 14 months only in the afternoon. Sunday was considered a holiday. And did you get enough food? In the morning, a cup of tea and a loaf of bread. We have such round bread nowadays. This was in the morning, and when we came back from work, we would get cabbage. Cabbage? Cabbage at noon, cabbage in the evening, cabbage from Monday till Sunday. Cabbage, everything with cabbage. Had you ever written home? Nothing happened. Nobody got any letter. Also, there were people who sent letters, those who had paper and everything prepared. But to get something, never. So nobody got anything from the country. But from there, did you send anything? If you wrote, did the letters arrive home? I never heard such a thing. You came back to Romania in 1946, didn't you? You had stayed there for a year, didn't you? A year and a half. 13 months. 13 months? A year and a month. From February to the 1st of March 1946. Was it by accident that you left so quickly? Nobody told you anything. Everything was, as I told you, in 10 minutes you had to pack your bags and leave. They took us, they threw us in the wagons, and the train was already in motion. From Banat in the mountains in the year 1945, approximately 10,000 German ethnics were deported. At present, in the whole Banat in the mountains, there are fewer than 120 people alive, and around 50 of them are from Reșița. Each year in Reșița and also in the whole Banat in the mountains, manifestations are being organized to commemorate the moment of deportation. In living memory of those who died in Siberia, a monument of deportation was raised in the center of Reșița in one of the parks. The testimonies of those who survived the Soviet camps, men and women, today they are old people, are touching. It might seem surprising, but they still remember what they went through, some of them even with minute details. They are former deportees now, at the venerable age of 80, and they remember their way to Russia, but also many of the happenings there. The former deportees speak about the hard work they did in the camps, about the shortcomings that they had to endure far away from home. Maybe the most impressive memories are related to the fact that every moment they expected to be killed one way or another. The memories related to the fact that their fate lay in their hands and that they didn't have any prospect of the following day are still alive in the memory of the former deportees. Many of them, upon their return home, lived with the fear of deportation. Even today, there are moments when they are afraid to talk. Others left Romania, either the communist Romania or Romania after 1989, and now they live in Germany or in the other places of the world. Anton Ferenschutz, a former sportsman, plastic artist and writer, left Reșița 30 years ago and now lives in Bielefeld, Germany, in the North Rhine-Westphalia, and speaks about all the experiences of that period. Where are you deported? After Ural Mountains? Is a city named also Unroia is known for the exploitation of gold and platinum. It's characteristic for this region. That's why there were dredgers there. I don't know if people know what a dredge is. They made some dams in order to raise the level of the water, and with these dredgers they excavated the land, and automatically the land was washed and the ore remained. And the result of the day was 3 kilograms of gold. From how many deportees those 3 kilograms of gold? We worked there, I think, 30 people, but there were also Russians. 3 kilograms of gold per day from 20 people, isn't it? Yes, yes.
Și rezultatul unei zile a fost de 3 kilograme de aur.
De la câți deportați 3 kilograme de aur?
Noi acolo am lucrat, cred, 20 de oameni. Au fost și ruși.
3 kilograme de aur pe zi de la 20 de oameni.
Da, da.
Am vreau să vă întreb.
I want to ask you something. How much time did deportation last for you? 3 years and a half. From 1945 to 1949, when you were deported, what did you know? How did you find about deportation? I was a bit naive, I guess. Nobody thought about this during the war. I remember that some huge posters were displayed against the Soviets, that the Romanians were the enemies of the Russians. I remember that some wagons were represented drawn in a line, and on the last wagon, a Soviet soldier stood only the skeleton, and it was written, "Never." That is to say, we will never be deported. This was during Antonescu's time. Still, this thing happened. But in 1945, at the beginning of the 1945, how did you find out that you were about to be deported? I said I was naive. Before being shipped, one might say, it was announced that all the Germans had to go to the police station and those who don't go will be fined. And of course, we, the people, honest citizens, went there like sheep to sign up on the list. When did this happen? This was at the beginning of January, around the 4th or 5th of January, because two Russian soldiers with a Romanian soldier came with this list to pick us up from home on the 16th of January. They entered the house. On the list, there was only me. My sister, who had a small kid, was exempted. I was the only one in my family that they picked up. My father wanted me to hide. He also wanted to go in my place because they weren't checking. Ferenschutz Anton, they asked me how old I was, things like this, and who was on the list. Was picked up and taken to the concrete school. The concrete school was in the old city of Reșița, which was close to our house. There were gathered around, I believe, 400 people. women, men, youngsters from 17 to 45 years old for men and 42 for women. But did they tell you that they were about to deport you? No, they didn't, but we realized that. When they picked you up, what did they actually say? They said that they picked us up to take us to the concrete school where we'll be checked. So didn't you make any sort of preparation before deportation? The preparation was made a day in advance, because people were already talking. Some Romanian acquaintances, who had some connections with the police, let us know that the following day we would be picked up. I happened to go to school that day. I was a student at the technical school and I crossed the bridge. On the bridge there were two Russian guardsmen who were checking the people, and those who were, how should I put it, of that age, who had the names they were looking for, they took them immediately. They didn't even let them go home. They took them, the truck was already prepared, they got them inside the truck and were taken to the center where the people were gathered.
Era cea mai aproape de la casa noastră. Acolo au fost adunați circa, cred, vreo 400 de oameni. Femei, bărbați, tineri, de la 17 ani încolo, până în 45 de ani la bărbați și la 42 de ani la femei.
Dar v-au spus că vă deportează?
Nu mi-au spus, dar ne-am dat seama că...
Când v-au ridicat, ce au spus de fapt?
Ne-a ridicat de acasă și să ne ducă la școala de beton, unde vom fi verificați.
At the age of 17, I was pretty thin. I looked younger, and the Romanian soldier looked at me and my school report and told me, "Son, go home and watch out. You're being deported. Prepare yourself or run, hide, do something." This is what the soldier told you, the Romanian soldier. The Russians saw that he was talking to us, but they didn't intervene. So I went back home and I told my parents what had happened. For example, there was a neighbor of ours who had three daughters. Just imagine, all the three girls from 17 to 25 or 28 years old were taken. Their mother was a widow. Her man had died and she remained alone. So there was an atmosphere. On one hand, I wasn't prepared. As a young boy, I thought that it wouldn't last long, that the war would end and they would let us go and we would stay a month or two. Of course, during those times, I blamed the Russians. If they hadn't come, I wouldn't have left. And why the Germans, we asked ourselves. And the Russians told us. There were also a few people who knew Russian. There was also a translator. They told us that the Russians, that is to say the Soviet army, asked from Bucharest 100,000 people as labor force, as compensation from the Romanians. Partial compensation. Yes, of course, partial. And by all means, the Romanians said, why should we leave? Let them go, because the Germans were all the time on the German side. Many of them left as volunteers in the German army, so it's them who should leave. I didn't understand very well back then, but this is the way it was, I realized in the end. The first convoy, after they had us arrested, we can say we were arrested, left on the 18th, I mean the first train. 18th January. We were kept there for two more days, because an acquaintance as a translator had there some connections and he retained the list for a while. We left on the 20th. We couldn't get out from school. We didn't have any connection. For example, my mother, poor her, looked for some lawyers who were said to be able to give you foreign citizenship. For example, I was given Hungarian citizenship. And she brought a paper which certified the fact that I was Hungarian. She forged the papers? Yes, well, there were lawyers who took the money and the people trusted them. My poor mother strove to find these lawyers. Of course that the Russians didn't even look at the paper. And how did the journey begin? The journey began exactly on that day when my mother came with the paper. They took us on the trucks with barefoot clothes. I got down and my mother wanted to hug me, and a short Russian with a Mongolian face hit my mother with the Kalashnikov in the chest. My mother fell in a ditch there. And of course you realize how furious I was with the soldier. And this was the last time when I saw my mother, poor her. She was crying and she was desperate because I was still a child. There were of course wagons of shipping animals. A hole was made for the water closet, and there was also a tin stove, a very little one, and some wood for a day or two. So the wagon had an easel in the middle, and On the left and the right side, there were some boards filled up because you couldn't sleep on the floor in that cold. They knew where we were going and it was prepared accordingly. We didn't realize. At the beginning, we left our luggage on the platform. There were 40 people in a wagon, women, men, everybody together. Even nowadays, I still hear that noise. The rollers and the doors and when they put that latch, that's it. You're caught like animals. And then someone said that there were enough people. There weren't any soldiers left as they needed a soldier for each wagon. And I saw my father coming. My father was easy to notice because he was bald and he had only a bit of hair. And my father told me that the Communist Party, or how it was called during those times, socialist, and some leaders from Reshica and from the factories made an inquiry with the government and probably they won't take us. Of course that the things got worse because we weren't dressed properly for Russia. I had a winter coat from my brother. It was a bit large, but it was good quality and it was pretty nice and warm. I had a blanket and I stayed muffled because we had a little fire due to the fact we were running out of wood. The journey that we made is still fresh in my memory. The first time they gave us warm food was fish soup. A truck came, as you may see in the army, with a huge barrel with soup. And we queued up and they gave us soup to each of us, just like in the army. It was the first time we got warm food. In Ukraine, I forgot to tell you, it so happened that we didn't move for an entire day and using this improvised bedroom, you can imagine the girls and women would go in tows. One of them was holding the blanket. It was embarrassing, don't you think? The pile of dirt was pretty big. It almost reached the edge of the hole. The pile of feces. Yes, feces. One time when I went to the bathroom, I saw a hand. I wondered, what is this? It was a thin hand and when I took a better look, I saw a 6-7 years old boy, poorly dressed, so thin, with a white face, sick. He was looking for food. We still had some food. There were people who sacrificed a pig and they were throwing leftovers outside. And the child was looking for such leftovers. The Russian kid. Only then we realized what country we're going to and where we were about to arrive. If this child looks like this, I haven't seen such a thing before. One day a man died. He wasn't even so old, around 42. He was sick. He died and stayed with us in the wagon for an entire day. Dead. Dead. Till we stopped and we shouted to the sentry to let him know that the man was dead. Take him out. And he was pretty frozen because there were -10 degrees Celsius in the wagon. Imagine that. And we couldn't bury him. And the Russian showed us, I won't forget this scene, to put him on a fence, on his feet. I was younger and faster, and when there was something to be done, I was the first outside. Another one died some other time, a man, and the same thing happened to him. We didn't bury him. The Russian told us, don't worry, the Russian will bury them. And how much time did the journey last? 30 days. At Sverdlovska, they took us out from the wagons and got us on a smaller wagon as compared to the Romanian ones. We didn't have any idea where we're going. Did they take you all out from that train? Yes, they got us on the other wagons. They were very well prepared with food and so on. There was some pastrami, but it was too dry. How to boil it? How to fry it? There was some wood and some hay and straw bales. So you can sleep on. Yes, in these wagons we were fewer, 30 people. And then for 2 days we traveled to east. And one day, I won't forget, it was 3 o'clock in the afternoon and we stopped. The train stopped. We heard orders from the Russians. We looked outside and we saw a crowd of soldiers ready to meet us. I spent some time learning Russian. A neighbor of ours who was in the army, I don't know how he managed to obtain some Russian books, dictionaries. We both used to learn together Russian and he used to say, hey, this is my neighbor, because my father asked him to take care of me. And he was indeed a serious man. And we learned every day for an hour or two when we felt like doing it. I used to ask him and he used to ask me questions and so we learned a bit of Russian. It was no great matter. And this, I guess, it was my great luck. And when we arrived, they asked us who knows how to translate. I knew it, but I thought that if I raised my hand, I had to write also. Then they asked in German, who knows Russian? And I said, I know a little. And I said, I know a little. They said, look, you have under your command 20 people. You are responsible for them beside the guardsmen. There were minus 38 degrees Celsius back then. I won't forget. And the people, the population from East greeted us with stones, with icy snowballs, whatever they found, and they were swearing and shouting, "The Germans, the murderers, death to the fascists." And I guess that they were probably prepared to do so because they were lined up. At East, we were a battalion. A battalion means 1,000 people, over 1,000. The camp wasn't new. It was about 50 years old. The next day, we had to gather in the dining hall, in the canteen, and they called out the list that they had from Reshica, already translated in Russian. And they called us and one by one told us, "This is your number," as they couldn't pronounce our names. So each of us received the number. Or they didn't want to. They didn't. My number was 177. Each had to write about the acquaintances from the camp, school, family and factory. Because we are all from Reshica and we knew one another, we wrote everything, even if we were involved in politics or not. We wrote about whether you belonged to some kind of political organization, if you were or weren't in the war. There were some of us who were on the battlefield. I wrote everything, because I thought that they would find out the truth anyway. I wrote about the fact that when I was in school I entered into the German youth organization. My brother left as a volunteer for Germany. I didn't write the word voluntarily. He actually volunteered to join the SS. The political commander came and made a speech about the dialectic materialism. I have never heard of such a thing before. He offered us books. We had a library in German. He told us that Germany was not only a fascist country, but also a democratic Germany which has a future too. It was about to become communist. A young teacher came. He knew German perfectly. He was teaching us natural sciences. We started with Darwin, with the evolution. I didn't realize where he was getting at, but it was very interesting. He would come twice a month and later every week. If we attended those classes, they gave us half a liter of milk. This was like an incentive, as it happens with the kids when you give them a candy to learn a poem. Yes, that's right. I thought only of the milk they gave us, that it was going to help me, to keep me fit. The food was worse and worse. It was brainwashed. After 2 months, I was quite young and still couldn't compare things, but I realized that I was used to politics. My father was a trade union leader. He was doing politics. Since I was a child, I knew what a collective contract meant and how the workers fought for the pay raise. Do you know how it was like in the 30s? I knew everything since I was a child. They told us that the fascism doesn't have a scientific background at all. What does fascism rely on? The communism relies on evolution, on science. There is a book that reads, "Man created God on his own image, so we shouldn't believe in God any longer." Right? That teacher was such a specialist. He must have done that for years. And you were so sensitive. It was the so-called anti-fascist school. Exactly. The anti-fascist school. Exactly, and after a year I became a member of the anti-fascist committee of the camp. We were 9 people in that group and I was the youngest. The others were nice people, men who had gone through union work and were politically prepared. I was doing politics with them too. And soon after, all the ideas I believed in vanished. And from a young adolescent National Socialist follower, you became a communist follower. Not just yet, but I had an inclination for it. And because the administration of the camp took interest in me, during the second year, I was appointed as brigadier to command an 80-people brigade. It was winter in February. The winter in February is as cold as in December. It's even worse because the wind is blowing, storms come and it's very unpleasant. There was a woman in my brigade who had 2 kids over 2 or 3 years old at home and she was wheeling the land while we're doing some dams in order to raise the level of water for the dredger. One time I saw that she was missing. I went to look her and I found her. She had taken off the boots and she had entered the water. When I saw, I screamed at her, "What are you doing?" And she told me, "I want to freeze my feet so that they would send me home." I slapped her and I took her out of the water and I rubbed her feet with snow very, very well till she started to scream with pain. "If you continue to scream, I'll slap you once more and if I tell this to the Russians, they'll send you to prison." It was a very serious situation if you did such a thing. The only thing that mattered to me was the fact that she had two kids back home who were waiting for her to come back, and she was to get back home with both her legs amputated. And when I came back home, I was already married, I was with my wife on the bus in Reshica, and I met her. She started to scream, "This man sold us to the Russians, he beat me!" You realize how I must have felt in the situation 5 years after. Of course, there were people who thanked me because I was appreciated by many. However, there were such cases. And where else did you work? They sent me to a private company. Some guy from America got a license. Don't ask me how. To dig out some gold from some land they had bought. And he bought some machines, some mighty pumps, as big as cannons. There must have been some arrangement precisely for them to receive those machines and copy them afterwards. I don't know. But that American was a Jew. His name was Schwartz, a German Jewish name. At the Kolkhoz, I recovered. I ate well and I kept fit. That's why I got into that. With those powerful water jets, we washed the hills. Some waterways, isn't it? They washed the hills, the land. It was advancing around 100 meters per day. We built some canals and all this land together with the water was flowing into a ditch where there was a sieve. The heavier matter like gold used to stop there in the sieve. That washer had two or three levels. At the end of the process, there were some rugs in coconut fiber, a bit basic, which they washed. You could find there 30-40% gold, and after that, those rugs were taken to another factory where they were being washed again. That was the hardest work that I did in Russia. Washing the land with those water jets caused some blockings due to trees and branches. Just imagine that we had to get in the water and take those things away in order to free the flow. We got some boots, but it was winter and the land was frozen. I worked there for about 3 or 4 months. It was the hardest work for me. Did you have any relation with your parents during your detention? I was allowed to write 3 times. I didn't get any letters. Did they receive yours? Yes, they gave us some brown paper, wrapping paper, because they didn't have white one.
Este o carte care spune omul și-a crezut, s-a creat Dumnezeu după înfățișarea lui. Deci să nu mai credem în Dumnezeu, nu? Era atât de specialist tot, probabil am făcut ani de zile acest lucru.
Și dumneavoastră erați atât de sensibil, era școala antifascistă, așa se numea.
Exact.
Școala antifascistă.
Da. Și după un an de zile am devenit și în comitetul lagărului antifascist. Am fost 9 oameni, dintre eu cel mai tânăr, ceilalți erau oameni de treabă, bărbați care treceau prin muncă sindicală și vorba aia, politic, pregătiți. Și eu țineam cot cu ei, politică, făceam, Robeo s-a terminat, fascismul învins. Deci toate ideile care eu am crezut în ele s-au spulberat.
Și din tânăr, adolescent, adept al național-socialismului, ați devenit adept al comunismului.
Încă nu prea tare, dar înclinare a fost foarte. Și fiindcă eram și la, cum să spunem, obiectivul conducerii, anul 2 am preluat o brigadă de 80 de oameni și eram brigadier.
What incident from your entire existence marked you the most? This incident happened when I was a brigadier. The people would gather at the gate and I was always checking them to see if they were properly dressed for the weather outside. When the temperature was minus 40, minus 45 degrees Celsius, they had to... But did they take you out to work at minus 45 degrees Celsius? There was a minimal temperature when they were allowed to take us, but they were always lying to us. They didn't take out the people from the Donbas region. Well, there was a law. If the temperature was under minus 45 degrees Celsius, they weren't allowed to take us out. So, as I told you, I had to check everybody, and there were a lot of people. I had around 80 people. I saw a girl in the line, all wrapped up in some woolen coat. She was wearing army boots on her feet. With those boots, you couldn't resist. She had to wear felt boots. And I asked her, "What's wrong with you?" She said, "Well, he sent me to work." I asked her, "Who?" She replied, "The chief of the camp." So the German, not the Russian. If the doctor said that you were capable of work, the chief of the camp had to send you to work and he was responsible for you, but you needed to have the proper clothes. But he didn't give her a padded coat and felt boots and he sent her to work. I got her out of the line and I told the Russian sentry, "Watch out, she can't live like this, especially because she has recently returned from hospital. She had pneumonia." But in some other brigade, my sister was sent to work. She ended up having 40 degrees fever. She was hospitalized and the second or the third day she died. The man who sent her to work was from Boksha. This man was the administrator, the commander of the camp. He had a relationship with a beautiful 18 years old girl. She made advances to him in order to have a better life. And they were living very well, having their own room and kitchen. And when I heard that she had died, I went to him determined to hold him liable for what happened. He was to be blamed for that. When I opened the door, his girlfriend greeted me. "Where is Yetner?" I asked her. "He's over there," she told me. "Call him," I said. And here comes Yetner, all dressed up in an embroidered red velvet jacket, like a boyar. I felt like chucking him. I was determined to be very hard on him, and I let him know that when we returned home, I would take him to court for what he did. I would never give up till he got punished, because he was guilty for some other things as well. He started to scream, I screamed too, he grabbed me, I pushed him back, and I saw that his eyes were looking for a hook near the stove. I was faster than him, I put my feet on it, and I don't know how, he pushed me and I fell on a pile of wood. I took a piece of chopped wood and hit him in the head with it. What happened after? Were you punished? He fell down in a faint. His head started to bleed. I turned my back on him and his girlfriend started screaming like mad. "He killed him! He killed him! Help!" The whole camp knew in a half of hour that I killed him, but fortunately he wasn't dead. So I just stood for about an hour without knowing what to do. Suddenly two soldiers came and said, "You're under arrest." They gave an envelope to the driver and told him, "Hand him at Yolkina camp." Yolkina means in Russian little fir tree. There was a village where there were only wood choppers, basically an extermination camp. There was very little food, hard work, and the workload for wood was very high, so we had to produce a lot. And worst yet, the commander of the camp was a very mean person. So, as I was saying, we had been going for an hour and suddenly the car stopped in the middle of nowhere. At night, in the Urals, it was so cold, and the car stops and the driver tells me, "Get out." I got out, he handed me the envelope and left. Can you imagine how I must have felt? There was no house, nothing. At night in the snow, you can see very well, and there were also the stars shining bright. It was a remote area and no proof of life. What am I supposed to do now? I wondered. I kept thinking of my father telling me that in the war, if you became sleepy and it's very cold, you can freeze there. And I was sleepy. I wanted to cry, so I cried. What should I do, dear Mother of God? I wondered. And I guess I stayed there without moving for about half an hour. And I kept wondering what to do, where to go. To the left, to the right, there wasn't any road. Suddenly, I saw a very small light, like a candlelight, 50 meters away in the distance. Was it really something, or was it only in my imagination? And I decided to go there. There was hope. Indeed, when I got closer, there was a dredger, and I knew dredgers very well because I worked on one. It wasn't working, and it was being repaired. Whatever, there was a man, so I entered, I greeted him, and he must have thought that I was a Russian. I asked him if there was a camp for Germans in the area. He told me, "Camp 20. How far is it?" I asked. 5-6 kilometers away, he told me. After an hour, I heard the sound of a bell, ding-dong, from a sleigh. I got on the sleigh and went to the camp. When I got to the camp, but what am I talking about? It was more like a house outside the village, 500 meters away from it. It was a camp for the outcasts. That's where I'm supposed to stay, I said to myself. There was a stove inside, but there wasn't any wood. There were iron beds, which were welded, very basic. I stayed there till the end. And what did you do there? I worked with wood. I had never cut a tree before. And you stayed there till the 9th of June. 1948. 1948. How did they let you know you that you're coming back home? We were working in the woods and a horseman came because the sawmill was 6 kilometers away from the camp and he told us to grab our bags and walk 20 kilometers all the way to the central camp. That's where all the people from all the camps used to come. From Siberia? No, from East. There were 5 more camps and they were all dissolved. And they gathered us in a strategic point where there was a railway and everything arranged. And how many did you gather there?
Și-a dat oprește, zice, dă-te jos. Eu mă dau jos, el îmi dă plicul în mână și pleacă. Vă dați seama în ce stare am fost? Nu era casă, nu era nimic. Noaptea în zăpadă se vede foarte bine așa și era stelele care luminau. Deci departe nu era o mișcare de viață. Deci eram acum ce fac. Tot venea în gânduri ce mi-a povestit tatăl meu în război, că dacă îți vine somn în frig, să știi că îngheți acolo. Și mie mi-a venit somn. Mi-a venit așa o situație, nici nu pot să vă descriu. Mi-a venit să-mi plâng, am și plâns. Ce fac, mama Domnului? Și cred că am stat cam o jumătate de oră pe loc. Și gândul mi-a mers așa, cum era cu să fac? Să, unde mă duc? În stânga, în dreapta? Nu era șosea. Da, odată văd așa cam vreo 5 de metri, o lumină foarte mică, parcă era o luminare. Zic, dar e ceva sau numai fantezia mea? Păi mă duc acolo, acolo e speranță. Într-adevăr, când mă apropie, era o dragă din ăsta pe care am cunoscut foarte bine, că am lucrat la dragă, care era în remont, adică în stare
de
reparație. Și nu mergea. Și totuși era un om acolo.
We were around 400 people, 300, 400 people. And you told me that they undressed you and gave you clothes. And how did you travel back home? When we arrived in the camp, there were wagons already prepared for us. There were still wagons for cattle, but they were very nicely prepared. They were waiting for all of us to gather there, and then the commander made a speech, thanking us for our work there. And he also told us that we're going home to build the socialism and stuff like that. The journey back home lasted less than 14 days, 12 days more exactly. And where did they bring you? To Reșița? They took us to Focșani. They handed us over in Focșani to Romanian army. In Focșani there was a camp divided into 2 parts. So I entered in the Russian camp where they gave us a letter written in Russian. What was written in the letter? In the letter they said the following. The convict, the name, leaves the Soviet Union healthy and satisfied, so he doesn't expect anything from the Russian state in return. And you signed it. I signed it. Everybody received that letter. We didn't even look. All we wanted was to get away. We handed the paper in the Romanian camp and they gave us one in Romanian. And you arrived in Reșița. I didn't wait for their transport. I left with a colleague and caught a train to Iași and then Bucharest. And we got on that train only with the discharge from duty papers they gave us. They said they would give us a train ticket. And they didn't. Well, I supposed to wait for another day. And you didn't wait anymore. I didn't. And you arrived in Reșița.
Ne-a preluat armata română. La Focșani era un lagăr împărțit în două. Deci am intrat în lagărul rusesc, unde ne-am dat o scrisoare rusă scris.
Ce scria scrisoare?
În scrisoare a spus așa, deținutul sau care a fost, numele cutare, pleacă din Uniunea Sovietică, sănătos.
De ce iubiți Reșița?
Why do you love Reșița and consequently Romania? I feel bounded to the history, the childhood history, my friends, all that friendship means. Friendship is differently perceived by people. For me, friendship is mutual. It's not only about giving. You involuntarily expect friendship in return. And you love it so much that you wish to return to the ground of Garuna in the afterlife? No, I'm asking you a question now. I'm not a poet, but I guess that every man writes a poem or something in his life. Why do you think I wrote all my poems in Romanian, even if I graduated to the German school? My influence is German, and if it's something from the soul and poetry comes from the soul, why am I not writing in German? The German words are not as spiritual as Romanian words. I was born in Reșița, among these hills. On these lands where I played as a child, I crawled through the grass that smelled nice, thousands of flowers and honey, and I see the summer. It's hot. I can feel it on my skin everywhere. It's only there that I found it. I think I have 5 or 6 poems in Romanian, but I can barely write 4 lines in German. When did you get rid of your convictions? When did you consider yourself disideologized both from communists and Nazis? The first time it was in Russia. From Nazis. And from communism? From communism when I realized that communist ideas, I don't know if they were communist, but theoretically speaking, the communist ideas are not better than the Nazi ones. When did you realize that? Well, it was when the security tried to get me on board.
Dați scăpat de aburii aceștia ai credinței când v-ați considerat dezideologizat și de comunist și de nazist?
Prima dată a fost în Rusia.
De nazist și de comunist când așa, v-ați dezvățat?
De comunist când mi-am dat seama că ideile comuniste, nu știu dacă au fost chiar cum, dar spunem teoretic, ideile comuniste nu sunt mai bune decât cele naziste. Oamenii au fost...
Când v-ați dat seama de asta?
Păi a fost în timpul ăsta când securitatea a început să mă copteze.
Each year, in Reșița, the Democratic Forum of the Germans from Caraș Severin, in partnership with the local authorities, organizes manifestations for the former deportees and in their memory. Thus, at the German Library, Alexander Tiz in Reșița, at the Romano-Catholic Church, Mary of the Snow, many meetings take place on this occasion dedicated to the victims of deportation as well as commemorative liturgies. At the monument of deportation from Reșița's park, the leaders of the deportated from Bocșa, Călan, Lugoș, Taierdorf and Reșița bring garlands and sing in German the anthem of the deported. Also, throughout the years, photographic documentary exhibits have been organized to confirm the direct and indirect consequences of deportation, its stages, statistics and documents drawn up the departure, respectively, the repatriation of the deportees. Many books have been written about deportation and many documentary albums have been published. The latest one was published 2 years ago and it is called Monuments and Commemorative Headstones for the Germans from Romania Deported in the Former Soviet Union, a volume by the German editor Erwin Josif Ziegler, president of the Democratic Forum of the Germans from Caraș Severin and organizer of the all manifestations dedicated to the deportation during the last 15 years. The moment of deportation and the drama that all these people had to face cannot and must not be forgotten by those who live in the area of Banat in the mountains. The history must be known so that it can be understood, and thus the mistakes of the past shall not be repeated.